Okay, I've been requested by a lot of people to do videos on what equipment I use, so I am going to try and do this. I'm going to be recording this from my phone, just so I can walk around and show you everything here. So, as far as soldering iron goes, this is a Hacco FX951. This is available for around 300 bucks. Last time I checked. The handpiece is the FM2027. Now, a lot of people have told me that using a micro pencil will be the way to go. However, I've honestly never felt the need for it. I use, this is a tip, particular tip is the BC1. I also have a large collection of other tips that you can find these tips for fairly cheap. Now, believe it or not, I'm fairly cheap when it comes to stuff like this, so I use the T12 chips. You can get a big collection of them for 28 bucks. So yeah, T12, and these, they all work fine. I mean, there's nothing wrong with these. I have not found one that has been any less powerful than the T15 series, and they're fairly cheap. You can get them, and this is a great iron, really, to do this for. It's not really a starter iron. This is a excellent iron to do your work on. It works great. So the second piece of equipment, most important, at least I think, is the hot air. So you'll get a lot of people that are trying to do stuff on these cheap 2-in-1 stations with a lousy iron, lousy hot air, and one thing to understand is these MacBook boards are, they're like 7 to 10 layers, and those cheap hot air stations will not cut it. They simply will not cut it. They're lousy, they don't have the airflow needed, the temperature's unstable, they just don't work well. So for my pick for hot air station is going to be the Quick 861DW. So the interface on this is very simple. You look at something like the Hacco FM or FR810 or whatever it is, the interface is absolutely lousy. It's hard to use, it's hard to understand, and most importantly, I've used those. They are loud, they don't work well. It's kind of a lousy station for 800 bucks. So the Quick is simple. You have temperature here. So you have your temperature button, you have your airflow right here. It has up to 120 liters per minute. Most of the cheap 2-in-1s are going to be like 20 liters per minute, so this has 100 more liters per minute, and the flow is just incredible on this thing. The handpiece is fairly comfortable. I like the handpiece. It comes with 3 tips. I don't really like the bent tips. They cut down on the airflow, so that's what I use. It has an auto shutoff, and it also has a tip remover right here, so you can take the tip off with this little fork here that the tip is in, and this is a nice station. The power supply that I use is going to be, looks like a Corad KD305P. Power supply is not that important. Get one that supplies 30 volts, up to 30 volts, and up to 5 amps. The amperage is the most important part, because when you're finding a short in a board, you want to have access to a large amount of amperage to find that short. So this is a cheap power supply. I think this was like 100 bucks. It does the job. It works. Get one that works. You don't need to go too crazy with power supply. Just get one that, one, isn't going to burn down your house, and two, works. Another very important part of this is make sure it has an option to disable overcurrent protection, because if you solder wires to a board with a short in it, with overcurrent protection, it is going to, it's not going to work. It's going to see the short and disable it. Last part, oscilloscope. You do not need one of these if you're starting. You absolutely do not need an oscilloscope if you're starting. This does help to check clock signals. It does help on rabbit hole boards that you can't figure out what's wrong with it. Do I use it much? Not really. Is it a nice thing to have on the bench for when you do need it? Yes. Is it a requirement? Absolutely not. Yes, it can help you solve some rabbit hole boards. It helps to see noise in some lines that may be causing some issues. It helps to look at clock signals that are maybe different on other parts of the board because they have noise in them and it's causing the board not to work. But is it essential? No. It's a nice thing to have. If you don't have the money, save your money for this. Spend it on something else. If you want to have it on your bench, by all means, it is a helpful tool when you do need it, but I don't see myself needing it that much. It is a Rigel DS1054Z. I think these go for about $349 or something like that. It comes with 3 tips. The tip is very nice. The probes are very nice. They do the job. They're nice, fine point like that. It's pretty nice. I like it. It does help sometimes, but it's not really essential. Microscope. This is an AMScope. This really, okay. The brand doesn't matter. They all come from the same place. I believe Lewis is selling them now, so I'd recommend go with that one. But this is like the older style that still allows you to put a adapter here. It's 7x to 45x. One very important part about this is it's simulfocal. So what that means is it allows you to use both eyepieces and the camera. This is very important. The regular trinocular ones, they have a little slide right here that you pull out, and that disables one of the eyepieces in order to let you use the camera. Simulfocal allows both eyepieces and the trinocular port to work. As far as the camera goes, I have no idea what brand this is. I bought it from someone that had them new. It had no branding, but all I know is it's 1080p, has both USB and HDMI, and seems to work. It kind of screws up audio sometimes, but it does work. It was like 100-something bucks, and for what it is, it does a good job. Multimeter. This is the multimeter I recommend, and it has a very, very important function that will save you time. When I say this is something to spend money on, I really recommend it. My phone fell. Give me 1 second here. It's probably going to be a lousy video, but still accomplishes what I need to get done. So this is the FLIR DM166. This is a very good multimeter. It's an auto-ranging multimeter. Has, you could set your manual ranges as well. However, the really important part about this, so you have your multimeter, and built-in, hit this button right here, you have built-in thermal imaging. And the thermal imaging part of this camera is actually very good. So I will grab a board and show you. You know, the resolution is fairly good. It's very sensitive, so let's look at the mat. I'm going to place my hand on the mat for a second here. And you can see it's still sensitive to where I put my hand. And it's a good tool. You have several color palettes here. So you have the rainbow. You have, I think this is mixed iron and gray, or iron and blue. I don't know. But this is a nice tool to have. It's built-in thermal. I bought this, I think, for around $300. I think they're up to like $4-something now. But this is a good tool to spend money on. If you need a good multimeter with built-in thermal, get this tool. This is very good. They also have, I think, the DM185 or something that has higher resolution. I don't really need that, but I'm also going to show a comparison of how good the thermal imaging part on this is on a board. So I'm going to do that right now. So one thing to take in consideration, the image does not come out the same being recorded as it does on the board. So you see you have something getting hot right here, which is actually normal. It's just the ISL. But what, you know, like, how do you know what's getting hot? If it does look like low resolution, well, guess what? You have a button right here for laser, and it shows you exactly what's getting hot. It's off a little bit because it's not, it's you know, side by side. But it does give you a fairly good idea of what it is. Let's see what's getting hot over here. And that looks like it is a... something on the other side of the board, maybe near the SMC right there. But yeah, this does help. And if we go close, here's the thing about these thermal imagers: when they have to calibrate. So you'll hear it click a few times, and this is going to be really hard to see. But if you move in on the board kind of close, and the board is cold, so there's not going to be any temperature differences. So it's not really, this isn't going to be really a good test. But if you get a board that's on, and you hold it up to the board, you can actually see the different components on it. This board doesn't turn on, it's not getting hot. But you can differentiate between capacitors and other chips and stuff. It works really well. You're not going to see that if there's no temperature differences on the board. And that's actually, I wonder if that's what's wrong with this board, because I haven't been able to figure this board out. So I wonder if that's a clue right there to what's wrong, because it's not entering an SO state. So I'm going to investigate that in a minute here. And this may have just helped me solve this board that I've been trolled on for about a week. So this is a very good multimeter. It's very responsive on voltages. It has a large number of features. It can measure capacitance. So if you do RF stuff, that's fairly important. Let's go back over here. So it's very responsive. It has a lot of features. The battery life is actually very good. So with two AA's, it lasted me probably about 15 days, and that's with this LCD. Shut off. Really? You reboot the minute I'm recommending you? Oh, well. Probably bad reason that's seated all the way, because I just changed it yesterday. But this is a very good tool. I recommend it. It works very well, and this is one of the best things I bought, I think, for my business. Workstation monitors. I used to have a 4K, big 4K screen. However, I got rid of that because it was causing me eye strain, and I didn't really like it. I think it's much more important to have two monitors side by side for board view and schematic than it is one big 4K screen. The aspect ratio is pretty much the same, so it's not really going to make too much of a difference. So if you have a board view right here, right, open up your board view, and that monitor is glossy, so you can only see my reflection. PDF pops up. Bring your PDF over here. You can, let's say, just right-click on the... find something to right-click on. Search PDF. And it pulls it up right here. It's really helpful to have two monitors instead of one, and this is what I recommend over a big screen TV. And most all, two 1080p screens are fairly sufficient for resolution, and they don't really cause as much eye strain as one of the big 4K TVs have. As far as the computer that runs this, I know if maybe someone's getting into looking at videos, it's not terrible, but it's probably not the fastest recording computer in the world. Let's see, because I don't even remember what this has. System information. Looks like it's going to have Ryzen 7, 1700, 8 core. Let's see, how much RAM does this have? 16 gigabytes. And I believe the graphics is an RX something or other. I think RX 580. Yeah, this is an RX 580. So that's what I have for my recording computer. Moving on to another very, very important piece of equipment in your shop is an ultrasonic cleaner. If you have a $100 ultrasonic cleaner, throw it out and invest in a better one. So prior to getting the Crest, I recommended the SharperTech XPS 240. As it fit most MacBook boards, it cleaned very good. It just seemed like an overall good cleaner. Now, I still think that is an excellent cleaner. However, the heater died after about a year. So I don't know if more and more heaters are going to start dying on them or if they're going to be reliable. Maybe I got a fluke. But at this time, I can't really recommend it if the heater is dying in a year. By all means, the SharperTech is an excellent cleaner. It may be even a little bit more powerful than the Crest, but overall, the Crest PowerSonic is a better cleaner for a few reasons. One, heater. So the SharperTech took like 2 hours to heat up to 70 Celsius. This takes like 30 minutes. It heats up very, very quick. As far as interface, I kind of like the SharperTech better. This Crest does not have an option to shut off the display. It only has options to turn on the heater and ultrasonic and stuff. But this is a very good cleaner. It cleans really well. SharperTech, if you're on a budget, you don't have $900 to spend on a cleaner, or even more if you want to get the bigger one. They're actually out of stock of the bigger one. Else I would have got that, but I needed one quick. If you're on a budget and you know you want to spend around $400 for a cleaner, get the SharperTech. Build your business, and then if it dies, whatever, get this one. Now the SharperTech does have a 2-year warranty, but the like on the heater and that, you have to cut open the tank, and after a year, it's parts only warranty. So this tank size, this can fit most MacBook boards. As far as the touch bar boards, you have to put them in kind of slanted. So I'll show you. It's like this board. It fits in, but you know, you might have to reposition it, you know, when you clean it. It's not a big deal. It still works. It doesn't really bother me, but that's one thing to consider. This is a Crest P500H-45, I think. I would have got the 1200H, whatever it is, but like I said, it was out of stock and I needed a bigger one, but this is a good cleaner. This was $899 with the tray and basket. So this is my current pick for an ultrasonic. Okay, ultrasonic cleaning solution. Branson EC, nothing else. This stuff is good. Do not put alcohol in an ultrasonic cleaner. I get comments from these store owners that are telling me they're filling this with ultrasonic cleaners. Do not do that unless you want to cause an explosion. Okay, you do not want a flammable fluid in something that is vibrating. Okay, this tray can vibrate, cause a little spark, and then the cleaner explodes and your shop burns down. Do not put alcohol in an ultrasonic cleaner. One, it doesn't work. It's just going to smear the alcohol around, the flux around on a board. It doesn't work. Branson EC, it's cheap. It's like $12 a quart, and I believe it was like $50 for this case of cleaner. I got this from AllSpec. You can get it from AllSpec. It's reasonably priced. It does a really good job. It's kind of toxic, so don't breathe it or drink it, anything like that. But this is pretty much the stuff you need to get. This works good. If you're outside of the U.S., then I can't really suggest anything because this is only available within the U.S. But if you can't get this, look for some kind of flux cleaner. some kind of flux cleaner or contact cleaner for ultrasonic cleaning, it's very important to use a fluid design for an ultrasonic cleaner, because the type of fluid used does affect the way the sound waves propagate in the water. Now, a good starter scope, if you're just starting out, is going to be this right here. This is an AmScope SE400. They're about $200. This is a good scope. I mean, it's a good starter scope. Let's see. You probably can't see through there, but I will try and give you an idea of what the image quality is like. Let's grab a board. Stick it under here. Try and focus it. This is going to be incredibly hard. Now, if you want to do recording or anything, then this is probably not the best option. I can't focus it, I don't think. There we go. So yeah, this is what the image looks like, if you could see in there. Let me try and move it. Yeah, it's going to look like that. It's not terrible. By any means, it's not terrible. My phone's not focusing on the board. It's focusing on the dust in the lens. It'll get you through to get a more expensive scope. That's what I did. I used this scope for a while, then I bought the other one. So if you're on a budget, get this scope. It will get you there to where you can afford a better scope. It also has the 20x lenses that it comes with, but that looks like you're looking through a keyhole. It's almost useless. So yeah, this is decent, but it's, like I said, if you're starting out and you need a scope, get this one. But if you can afford the variable zoom one, I would go with that. And as far as where do you get parts wise, the best way to get parts is off of donor boards, with the exception of some chips that are available off of donor boards. Very important to have good sized tweezers. So my favorite tweezers are going to be these right here. These are, Vitas ST14. These are very good. They're nice, fine tipped. They're durable. Like, I've went through so many pairs of these Hakko CHP 3SAs in the time that I've went through one pair of those. So that's my first pick. This is my second piece. These are Hakko CHP 3SAs. These are cheap. These are, you know, like $3. I don't remember, but these are cheap. Screwdrivers, I use whatever. I have my, you know, my incoming cue right here. Then I just, these are from Beats Tech. Don't buy these. These kind of suck. Don't buy these, but they work. And then I have, I think, another Craftsman set that I got that has changeable tips. These are decent. Then another Weehaw set right here. But like I said, tweezers, it doesn't really matter. I mean, screwdrivers, just get some that you like. Don't go too crazy with them. Get anything that you like and roll with that. This right here is a general, I don't know, but it's a electric. This is helpful. You know, sometimes it's helpful. You're tired or whatever. This was cheap. I mean, if you want one, get one. But yeah, it works. That's pretty much it. Flux, I guess you guys all know what I use. This stuff right here. Amtec NC560 LFTF that I was going to sell, but I'm not currently going to sell anymore. But yeah, that's pretty much it. That's pretty much all my equipment, what I use. And yeah, that's about it. So thank you for watching, and I hope this helps you.